Welcome to Camberwell Salvos. We're glad that you're here, whether that's in person or online. Today is Palm Sunday. As you can tell, with the palms that are scattered around the hall. Today also marks the beginning of Holy Week. The band, they meet in the room behind the stage. And we were reminded that Holy Week is like a roller coaster. Our emotions are all over the place. Today is a day of rejoicing, but it's also a day of anticipation. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the people that had gathered, were anticipating that God would come and rescue them again. And so when they see Jesus' entry and his little band of followers waving palm branches and shouting slogans to God, they anticipated that he may be the one to come and to save them. And so today we come with this same idea, this idea that God will come again and save us and save us and save us over and over and over again. So today is a day of anticipation. But we will meet again on Thursday night. And then again on Friday. And Friday is very much a day of sorrow, a day of reflection, a day when we remember again this deep sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And then we finish Holy Week next Sunday. Again, it's a day of rejoicing, a day that we see again God's goodness for our lives. And so today, as we come today rejoicing and with anticipation and with knowing that the week will unfold before us, let's come and gather and honour the name of our God. I'm going to read to you a psalm. And this psalm was a psalm that was used as an entry into the temple at the time of the Passover. And so today we come and we celebrate Palm Sunday, but the people before us, the people of God, they gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, the day that God rescued them from the Egyptians. And as they gathered and as they came in and as they descended into the temple, there were people, a gathering of people that would welcome them with this psalm that says, "Please, Lord, please save us. Please, Lord, please give us success. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, shining upon us. Take the sacrifice and bind it with cords on the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever." And so let's do that this morning. Let's stand together and sing our praises to our God.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. We all sing, we sing, God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever and ever. Forever.
From the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Come here to give praise and give thanks to the God of gods, to give thanks to the Lord of lords, to Him alone who does wondrous and amazing things, to the one who comes in the name of the Lord, to the one who is worthy of all of earth's hosannas, whose faithful love endures forever and ever. So we're going to sing our praise to that King of Kings. We're going to sing His love.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love
and His people sing praise.
Sing praise. Sing praise. We sing
that forever. Forever God is faithful. And so our response to this faithful God is that we give thanks to God with a grateful heart, giving thanks to the Holy One.
Jesus Christ.
moment in this time, as we've been singing those words, sometimes we spend our concentration on the words. Let's just take some moment in the quiet to give thanks in silence with our hearts. Listen to the tune and the chorus initially, and then join us in the second verse. Please feel free. A beautiful song that sings of that gift of Jesus Christ being sent to earth, taking on the sins and burdens of mankind, and breaking the chains of death and sin and darkness as we see his triumphant resurrection.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory. Spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we come before you to give thanks. We give thanks as we turn our eyes to that day of celebration when you entered Jerusalem, raised with hosannas. And God, as we look to that day, we also know what is to come, and we know what you have done for us as individuals to save us from that deep, far chasm that separated us from you and condemned us to eternity without you, God. And Lord, we give thanks, we give our praise, our glory to you, our living hope, the name above all names. Amen. I invite you to take your seats as I invite Meredith.
Yes. Take your seats, but kiddies, don't take your seats. Can I get the kids up the front, please? And if you think you're in high school and not a kid anymore and you think you're too cool to come up the front, that's fine. But if you are in high school and you would like to come down the front, oh, look at that. Beautiful. Love it. Nice. Come and join me over here. And we're going to watch a video. We're going to watch a video of a story of a donkey called Dave. Okay? Is everyone down here? Thank you.
Dave the donkey, he's just a donkey. Dave the donkey, yeah.
Dave the donkey was so excited. He had been watching all week for Grandpa Donkey to get back from Jerusalem. Dave had some big news he had been waiting to share with him. Grandpa, Grandpa, guess what? I carried the king into Jerusalem. You're joking, Dave. No, Grandpa, I carried the king. I was standing out front, minding my own business, when the king's servant untied me and led me to the king. The king jumped on my back, and we charged down the hill and up the mountain to Jerusalem. The crowd waved palm branches and everyone cheered. Hooray for the king! Long live the king! We said goodbye and I headed home, leaving the king to get on with the job of being king. So, Grandpa, you've been in Jerusalem since then. Tell me what happened next. Did the crowd keep cheering for the king?
Okay, so when Dave the donkey says the king, what king's he talking about? Is he talking about King Charles? What king's he talking about?
Jesus.
He is talking about Jesus. And I absolutely love that, because Darren was just talking about Easter being like a roller coaster. And Palm Sunday is, and you know what, you guys are probably a bit young to have ever been on a roller coaster. You've been on a roller coaster. You know when your tummy feels all funny when you get to the top and it starts dropping? I'm going to come over here. I'm back to most people. So Palm Sunday is the top of the roller coaster, where you're really excited and it's, you know that the drip's going to come, the drop is going to come, and your tummy feels all funny. And the thing is, this time next week, it will be a bit of a different story, won't it? It'd be the bottom bit of the roller coaster. But today is Palm Sunday. Who knows why it's called Palm Sunday? It's because of the palm of your hand? Why?
Because when Jesus came in, people were waving palms.
Excellent. Now, I've got some branches here, and they are not palms. They're just random branches from my garden. But Grace, you know what they're... I walked in and you said they're such and such. What were they? They're peppercorn branches. I did not know that. But Grace identified these random branches from my garden the minute I walked in. So we are going to be reenacting Palm Sunday where you get to wave one of those around. And I know there's been a bit of a focus on the eye the last couple of weeks. Let's not focus on the eyes today. Let's try to keep away from our eyes. But we are going to reenact. So, Harriet, no offence, but can I get you to be my donkey? Because Harriet has been hitting the gym and she's pretty strong. So we need a donkey. Thank you very much. And who is going to volunteer to be my Jesus? Now, I might go with you, Emily, because I know that Harriet's your prayer pal and I've seen you many times on her back. So jump up. I have a cloak here, a Jesus cloak. Well, really, it's a Luke Skywalker Jedi cloak. But the Force was way more with Jesus than it ever was with Luke Skywalker. So do you want to pop that on? And do you want to hand out these branches to the kids? So what we're going to do is we're going to sing a song that is called Hosanna, because that's what people yelled out. They heard that this amazing person that they'd heard all about, this prophet, this king, they heard that he was coming into Jerusalem and they were like, let's go and meet him. And they waved them to say, yay, we're so excited you are here. Welcome to our town. And then that's the end of the top bit of the roller coaster. We're not going to go into that today because today is all about making Jesus the king. And he's Jesus is the king of our hearts. So what I want you to do is I want you to grab a branch and I want you to, yes, please. I want you to, and can you, donkey and Jesus, can you go to the back where Karen is? Come and grab a branch. Come on, jump up, grab a branch. We're going to line up down here and across here. And while the adults sing a song that they would know, you guys may not know it, I want you to wave the branch around nice and gently. They are nice soft leaves, I made sure. Daze, do you want to walk down? And we're going to line the streets. You're going to get one. We're not going to grab those ones. Not too far down. No, no, no.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with a heart full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord.
Waving the army flag around. Uncle Ian, bless him, would have been here waving his flag. It is really fun to wave something around, and they also waved their jackets and they put their jackets down because they were so excited to meet Jesus and they wanted to say welcome. And we want to say, Jesus, welcome into our hearts. This Easter period, let's welcome Jesus into our hearts and think about the fun times we've had with him, but also when we've had low times, how we can pray to him. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a very fancy exit. Girls, do you want to come up? We are going to sing. We've been singing, He is the King of Kings. The old He is the King of Kings song that I used to do in Sunday school. And when we go, oh, we are going to make a run for it out into Sunday school. Now, adults, you are going to keep going, oh, until every child has left the building. Now, what we're going to do is we are going to run this way and we're going to run around the back and see where Kelly is. We're going to run out that door and adults, take a big, deep breath. No, not down that way. We're going to go this way. No, take the leaves with you. Let's keep waving them. Shall we go?
He is the King of Kings.
The kids have loved singing that song. I love it. Sorry, Kez, I've hyped them all up and then they're yours in Sunday school today. So now we've got the band message and then after that we have the offering.
Thank you.
Thank you once again for your giving, and thank you, Richard, for your contribution. Our reading today is from Mark chapter 11, and I'm reading from the first verse of chapter 11. As Jesus and his disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the towns of Bethpage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them ahead. "Go into that village over there," he told them. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a young donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, 'What are you doing?' just say, 'The Lord needs it and will return it soon.'" The two disciples left and found the colt standing in the street, tied outside the front door. As they were untying it, some bystanders demanded, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They said what Jesus had told them to say, and they were permitted to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it, and he sat on it. Many in the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others spread leafy branches they had cut in the fields. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God! Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessings on the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Praise God in highest heaven." So Jesus came to Jerusalem and went into the temple. After looking around carefully at everything, he left, because it was late in the afternoon. Then he returned to Bethany with the 12 disciples. And so in Mark's gospel, that's where our reading ends today, with Jesus entering Jerusalem, entering the temple, having a look around, and then heading back out. Matthew, Luke, even John tell a different story, don't they? They tell how Jesus enters into the temple and how he drives out the people who were buying and selling animals and sacrifices, and he knocks over the tables. But not for Mark. Mark leaves us in suspense. We'll get back to that in a moment.
Okay, let me get this out of the way. I didn't steal that donkey, okay? I borrowed it. And it wasn't even my idea. Jesus told me to take it, to borrow it, right? Okay, this is how it happened. Earlier today, there was a large group of us, and we were traveling from Bethany to Jerusalem. We stopped just outside the city, and Jesus looked at two of us and he said there was an unridden donkey just inside the village and asked us to go get it. He said if anybody, you know, asked us about it, we could just look at him and say, the Lord needs it and he'll send it back. So the two of us beat it into town, and the whole time we were like, what is Jesus going to do with a donkey, right? But by this point, we realized you don't second guess Jesus, right? He hadn't told us why, and we didn't ask. We just got him a donkey. And when we got back, that's when it happened. Some people put their coats on the donkey, and Jesus got on the donkey. And when he got on the donkey, I don't know. It's like everyone started shouting and dancing and singing, and some people were throwing their coats in front of the donkey. There was some of us that grabbed some palm branches and we started waving them in the air. And that's when it clicked. Jesus had finally arrived. I know that sounds weird. It's like this. In the past, we would get excited because Jesus would do something, a miracle, or there would be some parable or something he said. We'd get excited about it. And Jesus would always be like, shh, come on, guys. No, nope. Just be quiet, you know. And then we'd come up with some idea. Hey, let's do this or let's do that. And Jesus would be like, no, guys, not now. Not now. But today? Today was now. Today, he finally let us shout and sing and dance and treat him like the Messiah that we'd all been waiting for. Finally showed up. I don't know. I don't know what tomorrow holds. It feels like it's something big, but who knows, you know? But it doesn't matter what happens because Jesus showed up. And there's nothing better than when Jesus shows up.
To get to Jerusalem, Jesus first had to travel through Jericho. And while in Jericho, a large crowd of pilgrims bound for Jerusalem decided to join Jesus and his motley crew. Now, why they chose to follow Jesus, we have no idea, because the gospel writer, whom we call Mark, doesn't feel it necessary to tell us. But what we do know is what happens next. As the crowd were leaving Jericho, a blind beggar who was sitting beside the road started to shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Now, how a blind man can see that Jesus is passing him by also remains a mystery. Once again, Mark is incredibly light on details. But what he does tell us is that the blind beggar's name is Bartimaeus. Now, B-A-R, means son of. And so he is the son of Timaeus. Bartimaeus, Timaeus. And the name Timaeus is an Aramaic word that means unclean or defiled. So in one sense, Bartimaeus means son of the defiled or son of the unclean. Imagine being called unclean or defiled all your life. Imagine the psychological damage that would do to one's self-worth. However, with all that said, all is not lost, because it's also possible that Bartimaeus' name is related to a Greek word that means highly prized or honoured. So if that's the root of his name, then his name would mean son of the honoured one. So which was it? Was Bartimaeus known as son of honour, or was he the son of dishonour? Again, we don't know. But what we do know is that as Bartimaeus started to shout, "Jesus, son of David, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me," the crowd who seemed to be in a hurry to get to Jerusalem for the Passover tell him to be quiet. You know, "Shush, Bartimaeus, shush," they cried out to him. "Quieten down." But this only made Bartimaeus shout louder, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And in the end, his shouting must have worked, because on hearing the man's shouts, Jesus tells him to come to him. So Bartimaeus, leaping excitedly, throws his coat aside. Or in other words, he abandons everything. Everything that's precious to him. Everything that protects him. And he runs to Jesus' side. Now, I don't know whether you could picture the scene, but I love how Jesus calls Bartimaeus to come to his side. And I love how Jesus does this, because I generally believe that Jesus continues to do that today. That is, calling people to his side. And the second thing I love about this story is that once Bartimaeus is by Jesus' side, Jesus asks him this incredibly generous question. "What do you want me to do for you?" Imagine that. Imagine sidling up to Jesus, and on seeing you, he asks you the same question. "What do you want me to do for you?" How would you answer it? Because let's face it, we all want something from Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asks the blind man. "I want to see," is his reply. So no surprise there, but see what? What exactly does he want to see? His friends? His family? The kingdom of God? Jesus? We don't know, because Jesus doesn't ask. Instead, this is what Jesus says to him next. "Go on your way, for your faith has made you well." Now, it's like on healing him, Jesus then dismisses him. "Off you go. Go and live your life." But Bartimaeus doesn't go anywhere. Like many others, he sticks with Jesus and follows him to Jerusalem. And this is where things get a little complicated, because the people of Jerusalem also want something from Jesus. But Jesus, it seems, has other ideas. But before I head down that path, I want to stay with the story of Bartimaeus just for a tad longer. Because the most intriguing thing that I find about this story is the language Bartimaeus uses to address Jesus. "Jesus, son of David," he shouts, "have mercy on me." And I find his description of Jesus intriguing, because it's not just Bartimaeus who refers to Jesus as the son of David. One of the most striking things about the Gospel of Mark's description of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem is that the crowds also call out for the Son of David. And I find this intriguing because the title Son of David appears only in these two stories. Everywhere else in Mark's Gospel, Jesus is referred to as the Son of Man, which is Jesus' favourite term to describe himself, the Son of Man. And the other term that goes all the way throughout Mark's Gospel is Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of God. In fact, this is how Mark commences his Gospel. This is the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. So not David. And this is the first words that the Son of God utters in Mark's Gospel. The time promised by God has come at last, he announced. The kingdom of God. So once again, not David. The kingdom of God is near. So repent and believe the good news. But it seems that when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the crowds were not interested in God's kingdom, but in David's. Let me read verse 8 to you again. Many in the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others spread leafy branches they had cut in the fields. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, Hosanna! Hosanna. Now, no doubt you've heard this before, that Hosanna's a Hebrew word that just, it means please save us. Hosanna, please save us. But it's also helpful to know that around the time of Jesus, the word becomes synonymous with a praise. You know, much like the way that we say hallelujah today. And so they're shouting hallelujah, and that's possibly why the New Living Translation uses the term praise God. So the people were shouting, hallelujah, or praise God, to the one who comes in the name of the Lord, or who comes from God. So that much they knew. But then they say, so that we may see the coming kingdom of our father David. And I'm labouring this point because when you go back and you read the story of King David in the Old Testament, it's pretty clear that David's kingdom grew through violent means. In short, David was a man of war and violent conquest. So much so that when David wanted to build a temple for God, the Lord God said to him, no, you are not the man to build my temple because you've caused so much carnage and bloodshed to the land and to the people of the land. Whereas God's kingdom, it comes not by force, but gently and humbly, riding on the back of a donkey. Now, the quintessential sign of peace. So I'm probably overstating the case here, but it's like you can call Jesus the wrong name or be a little confused about who he really is, yet he still graciously responds. And I say this because at no time does Jesus correct Bartimaeus or the crowd. You know, he never says to them, I am not the Son of David. You know, I'm the Son of God. No, it's like Jesus humbly receives their pleas and their cries of despair and their cry for freedom and the restoration of their land and nation. But he does so in a way that reaches beyond that is greater than what they were asking for. And this is what I mean by reaching beyond, giving something back greater than what they expected. And in Jesus' day, the temple in Jerusalem had three parts. The outer court, where anyone was welcomed into. And then there was the inner court, which was reserved for the Jewish men only. And then the Holy of Holies, which was a sacred space surrounded by a thick veil where no one was permitted to enter except the high priest. And even then, he could only enter once a year. And each year when this day came around, it was known as the Day of Atonement. And it's not like the priest could just turn up and head on in. 1 week before entering the Holy of Holies, the high priest was taken away from his home and taken to a secluded place where he would live completely alone. And these arrangements were put in place so that he couldn't accidentally touch or eat anything considered unclean. And so to ensure that no accidents happen, the other priests would attend to his needs. They would bring him food and such so that he can concentrate solely on preparing his heart. And then the night before the Day of Atonement, he wouldn't go to bed. Instead, he would stay up all night. All night to pray and to read God's word. All in an effort to purify his soul. And then he would wash from head to toe on the day before, dressing in pure, unstained white linen. And then clean inside and out, he would enter the Holy of Holies and offer an animal sacrifice to God to pay for the penalties of his own sin. And then he would leave the Holy of Holies, bathe again, and then dress again in a new set of pure white linen clothes. He would then enter the Holy of Holies a second time, this time sacrificing for the sins of the priests. And then he would leave, complete the cleaning ritual one more time, and then return to the Holy of Holies a third time, sacrificing for all the people's sins. But here's the thing with the cleansing rituals that took place. They were never done in isolation. On the Day of the Atonement, although only one man could enter the Holy of Holies as the representative for the community of God, the other parts of the temple were crowded. And they were crowded with the other priests who closely watched everything taking place, even the bathing, which thankfully took place behind a thin screen. And the people and the priests took so much interest in the ritual because they were concerned about getting something wrong. Because when it came to God, they had been taught that everything needed to be perfect and that everything needed to be clean and pure. Now, in the November of the second year of King Darius's reign, so about 520 BC, God gives the prophet Zechariah a vision. And it's laid out in Zechariah chapter 3. And it's a vision of Joshua, the high priest, standing before the presence of God in the Holy of Holies. But Joshua was wearing garments that were absolutely filthy. And on seeing this vision, Zechariah asked God, how how can this be? For there's no way known that the Israelites would have ever allowed the high priest to appear before God in such a filthy condition. And this, in essence, is what he hears back from God. That despite their best efforts to be pure, despite their best efforts to be good and to be moral and to be clean, God sees their hearts, and their hearts remain unclean. Defiled, in fact. Interesting, isn't it? In Jesus' day, the Aramaic language had a particular word for this. Bartimaeus. Sons of the defiled. So imagine how soul-destroying that must have been for them and for the prophet Zechariah. Because in Zechariah's day, just as it was in Jesus' day, the people of God were trying their very best. They did all that they could to ensure that the high priest stood before God clean, clean of heart, clean of body, and clean of soul. But even their best efforts fell remarkably short. But just as Zechariah was about to despair, the Lord God said to him, "All is not lost, Zechariah. Here is what I will do for you. I will send to you a new priest, a new Jeshua, a new Joshua. And today we know this Joshua to be Jesus." No, Jesus, Jeshua, Joshua, it's the same name in Aramaic, Greek, and Hebrew. And in many ways, Jesus staged his own day of atonement. 1 week before his crucifixion, the day that we now call Palm Sunday, Jesus enters Jerusalem. And in a symbolic gesture of what is to come, he cleans out the temple. He purifies it so that it's ready for sacrifice. Then the night before his crucifixion, he doesn't sleep. Instead, he spends the night praying. But then what happened to Jesus was precisely the reverse of what happened to the high priests of old. Instead of the crowd cheering him on, they called for him to be executed. And instead of being clothed in pure white garments, he was stripped of the only garment that he had. And instead of being bathed in water, he was bathed in human spit. And here's the most shocking thing of all. Jesus let them do it. And why? I think John 3:16 sums it up best. But this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. And so let me conclude in this vein, if the worship team want to make their way back up to the platform. That day, when Jesus enters Jerusalem, despite the crowd's misguided hopes and dreams, he does save them and us. But not the way we always expect or sometimes generally want. Sometimes the response from God, it's not immediate, or and it's certainly never through violent conquest. Now, Jesus' story, it's not one of vengeance or retaliation or calling upon God's wrath on the so-called enemy. Now, Jesus comes in peace, on the back of a donkey, of all things. The quintessential sign of peace. And he comes to heal and to restore. And he chooses a cross rather than an earthly crown. And in doing so, he changed their world and ours. Taking our evil and our prejudice and our indifference, he hangs it all on a cross so that we may find love and peace and hope and ultimately salvation. And so, like the crowds before us, we too have a choice. A choice to crucify or a choice to save. A choice to condemn or a choice to offer grace. A choice to live a path of destruction or a life of love. And so it's my prayer that you will walk the way of Christ. And by doing so, you too will experience the restorative power that comes from living with God. In a moment, we're going to sing again. And as we sing, I want to offer you the opportunity to come and bring the gift of ourselves or the gift of another this morning. Last Sunday, we brought our financial gifts to the altar or to the holiness table. But this week, as we enter Holy Week, I want to offer ourselves. Jesus asked Bartimaeus, "What do you want me to do for you?" I think that question's as relevant today as what it was back then. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asks. At the commencement of this Holy Week, what do you want from God? You know, this Easter, what do you want to see? What do you want to hear from God? What do you want to feel? What do you want to receive from our gracious God, who continues to ask, "What can I do for you?" On the table are these little cutouts of people. And so, as we sing, I'm asking that you come and you write a prayer on these cutouts and then leave them at the foot of the cross. Might be a prayer for you. It might be a prayer for someone else. Might be just a name of someone else, or someone who is dear or close to you. Maybe it's your name, your prayer. What is it that you want to hand over to God this morning? Let us do that at the commencement of this week as we sing. Thanks, guys.
In the light of his glory.
Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our pride. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh, Jesus, we turn our eyes to you.
Don't you love that while we gathered in here? our children have written the names of those people that mean the most to them. So know, mums and dads, that you're being prayed for. Prayed for by your children. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your love. That you're a God that reaches out to each of us. Lord God, we're all on a journey, all trying to do the best that we can, all handing over to you our lives, our things, our wants, our desires. And we do so knowing that you are a God of love, a God that cares, and a God that heals, healing us, healing our land, healing your people, this world in which we live. And so help us again to be your people, to be your person when we come up against those things that want to tear us down, or those people that want to tear us down. May we continue to offer our lives as a sacrifice to you. And so, Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice that we may today come to you in any condition, knowing that you are a God that responds. So, Lord, again, as we've brought our prayers and those people on our heart to you, we ask that you respond today. I pray. Amen. And amen. I'd like you to stand with me as we sing our final song for this morning. This reminder that this world that we live in is God's world. That this is our Father's world. Thanks, Jamie.
This is my Father. Trees are
and a benediction. God Most High, gracious and glorious, blessed is the one who comes in your name. Lead us now on the road to the cross. May we follow with faithfulness and joy, shouting Hosanna in the highest heaven, through Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord. May God bless you. May God go with you. Amen.